Good evening. I'm Graham Allison, director of the Belfer Center, and it's my great honor to welcome us all tonight here to the McNamara Lecture that's going to be given by former Secretary of Defense Bill Perry. Before introducing Bill, which I'll do briefly since there's information about him in the handout, I asked Bob Pastor, who's here, to say a word about Robert McNamara, for whom these lectures were named. Bill is actually giving the second Robert McNamara lecture, the first of which was given by Sam Nunn, one of the four horsemen with Bill in the topic that he's talking about tonight. And former Secretary of Defense McNamara came to that, and it was one of actually the last public events. McNamara, if you want to see here in the forum, if you go to the forum's website, which they put up, he was here as a guest five times previously. So there are a number of very lively forums with McNamara, from the missile crisis to Vietnam to other topics. And so Bob Pastor, who's a graduate of Harvard, graduate of the Kennedy School, professor at American University, is going to say a word to remember Bob McNamara. Bob Pastor and his wife, Margie, who is Bob McNamara's daughter, and this is his son-in-law, so Bob.
Thank you very much, Graham. I come here as son-in-law of Bob McNamara, and my wife, Margie, is the oldest daughter of Bob and Margaret McNamara, and I come here also as son of the Kennedy School, as a graduate here, and I did my master's and also PhD. Bob McNamara and I spoke many times about this lecture series. He, as you know, rose to the pinnacle of power as president of Ford Motor Company, as Secretary of Defense from 1961 to 68, and as president of the World Bank from 1968 to 1981. He cared deeply about war and peace, and he also cared at the end of his career about learning the lessons that he himself had drawn and that we all ought to draw from his experiences and from our nation's experiences as well. And therefore, he looked on this lecture series as an opportunity for the Kennedy School to reflect as he did on the Vietnam War, on the missile crisis, on nuclear weapons, for all of us to reflect on ways that we can improve our world. So we're very grateful to Graham Allison, who was my professor when I was here. He was a bit younger then. And to all of you for coming, and we're looking forward to annual lecture series on various dimensions of war and peace as well. So thank you very much.
So what to say about former Secretary of Defense Perry? I could take the time that we have for the lecture if I were to be fair. I would say that he's a most generous employer of many of the people who work here. So folks whom he's employed in his career include our colleague Ash Carter, but also John White, who's here, who was Deputy Secretary of Defense when Bill was Secretary, John Deutsch, who was Undersecretary when Bill was Deputy Secretary, Joe Nye and me, who were assistant secretaries. So he's a good person to know if you're looking for a job. He doesn't necessarily have the best taste in the selection of people, fortunately, so it was a great opportunity for us. But nobody who worked for Bill Perry will ever forget the great opportunity that that represented. If you ask about where are wise men and women in the American national security establishment in this generation, the answer is, well, we can look at a lot of cases of the absence of wisdom. I think that's easier to find. But one of the few people who would be recognized, I think, across the community as a wise man of this generation is former Secretary Perry. His career is inspiring for us all. He's been a great public servant. He's been an entrepreneur and business leader. He's an outstanding professor at Stanford. And he combines this remarkable mixture of imagination and strategy and management to make things happen. At the Defense Department, when he was Undersecretary for Research and Engineering, the job that actually Ash Carter is in currently, Bill was a leader in what was called the Military Technical Revolution, the symbol of which was stealth. Okay. The technology that's the stuff of the most advanced American military forces today. As Deputy Secretary and Secretary of Defense, he dealt with the North Korean nuclear challenge. When China decided that it would offer a missile barrage to Taiwan, he moved two carriers into the area and that stopped. When the question was what was going to happen for Bosnia-Herzegovina, and what was NATO going to do? He did the most imaginative thing. I still can't figure it out, even though I've analyzed it many times, and persuaded the Russians that they should join in this effort. But since, of course, they wouldn't join a NATO effort, he had them join and serve under an American general. Okay? So a very strange combination of things in which it's easy to have imagination. It's harder to do strategy, but to then do it in a way that it's managed so that the stuff happens, that's the most remarkable. So I would say we have a great opportunity to hear tonight, and it's quite fitting that Bill is coming after Sam Nunn as the second McNamara lecture, because the topic that he's chosen tonight, the nuclear tipping point, is a topic from a documentary that's been made, in which Sam Nunn, Bill Perry, Henry Kissinger, and George Shultz, the what I call the Four Horsemen, have advocated a very ambitious vision and agenda to do with nuclear weapons, and that's what he's going to tell us about tonight. So, Bill, thank you very much.
The one thing Graham did not say in his generous introduction is the subject on which I'm going to be speaking tonight. He has been one of my principal mentors through the years. On my first day as the Secretary of Defense, I walked into the Secretary's cabinet office, went over to the grand desk once used by General Pershing. The desk was empty, except for a lone book. It was Bob McNamara's book on the Vietnam War. Bob had evidently come in early that morning and asked my assistant to put that book on my desk. I opened the book, and there in the flyleaf was an inscription from Bob. He said, "Dear Bill, please read this book and learn from it, and do not make the same mistakes that I made." And so I began my tenure as Secretary of Defense. Often, during and after my tenure, I would meet with Bob and we'd discuss current issues. And to this day, I cherish the memories of those conversations. At our last meeting, just about a year before his death, Bob spoke passionately about the importance of the work that I was doing on nuclear weapons. And he was curious as to why I had taken a road so different from that taken by other secretaries of defense. I think the best answer to that question is found in some memorable lines from Robert Frost. "I shall be telling this with a sigh, somewhere ages and ages hence. Two roads diverged in the wood, and I took the one less traveled by, and that has made all the difference. During the Cold War, I took a well-traveled road, with tens of thousands of colleagues working on high-tech weapon systems designed to deter the Soviet Union. But at the end of the Cold War, I saw two roads diverging, and I chose to take the one less traveled by. Tonight, I will tell you of my personal journey on that less traveled road, a journey that took me from working to create the most advanced nuclear weapons in the world to working to create a world without nuclear weapons. I'm going to start by sharing with you two of my personal experiences during the Cold War. Experiences that were pivotal in shaping my views on nuclear weapons and leading me to this less traveled road. Very early in my career, when I was a scientist in an electronic lab in Mountain View, I received a phone call from a former Stanford classmate, Dr. Albert Wheelon, who at the time was the deputy director for science and technology at the CIA. And he asked me to come back to Washington to consult with him on a technical problem. I said, sure, I'll rearrange my schedule and see you early next week. And he said, you don't understand. I need to talk to you right away. So I dropped everything and took the night flight back to Washington. Met with him the first thing in the morning. I was stunned when he showed me U-2 pictures of a missile deployment underway in Cuba. And that was my first introduction to what has come to be called the Cuban Missile Crisis. For the next 13 days, I was part of a small team that worked every night studying the latest technical intelligence that was collected that day, so that President Kennedy had the benefit of that assessment the first thing the next morning. Every day that I went into this analysis center, I truly believed would be my last day on Earth. Some of you here tonight are too young to have personal memories of the Cuban Missile Crisis. So I'm going to show you the kind of news programs I watched when I returned to my hotel room after a long day in the analysis center. See if this works.
Khrushchev ordered his Navy ships to stay their course. The world anxiously watched as the high-powered showdown continued, with all-out nuclear disaster hanging in the balance. America held its collective breath as the president reiterated what was at stake.
It shall be the policy of this nation to regard any nuclear missile launched from Cuba against any nation in the Western Hemisphere as an attack by the Soviet Union on the United States, requiring a full retaliatory response upon the Soviet Union.
There was nothing ambiguous in that statement. Now I'm going to give you a brief excerpt from a speech by President Kennedy that illustrates just how deeply he felt about the danger and inhumanity of nuclear war.
Today, every inhabitant of this planet must contemplate the day when this planet may no longer be habitable. Every man, woman, and child lives under a nuclear sword of Damocles, hanging by the slenderest of threads, capable of being cut at any moment by accident or miscalculation or by madness. The weapons of war must be abolished before they abolish us.
The second experience occurred 16 years later, the time I was the Undersecretary of Defense for Research and Engineering. And I was sleeping in my bed one night when my phone rang at 3 o'clock in the morning. I picked up the phone, and the voice on the other end of the line identified himself as the general who was the watch officer that night at North American Air Defense Command. And the general got right to the point. He told me that his computers were indicating 200 missiles on the way from the Soviet Union to the United States. I immediately woke up. I still remember the general's words as if this happened yesterday. The computer alert, of course, was a false alarm. The general was calling me in the hopes that I might help him figure out what the hell had gone wrong with his computers, so he had something to tell the president the next morning about what had happened. Well, that call, of course, holds a special place in my memory. It is only one of three false alarms that I'm personally familiar with that occurred in the United States, and I don't know how many more might have occurred in the Soviet Union. So I had a close personal experience with the possibility of a nuclear catastrophe that could have resulted in no less than the end of civilization. And to this day, I believe that we avoided a nuclear catastrophe as much by good luck as by good management. Ironically, During the same period that I experienced the false warning of an attack by Soviet nuclear weapons, I was responsible for the development of America's nuclear weapons. The B-2, the MX missile, the Trident submarine, the Trident missile, the air-launched cruise missile, the Tomahawk missile, all of them. I saw all too clearly the risks in building such a deadly nuclear arsenal. But at the time, I believed it was necessary to take those risks. But in 1989, the Cold War ended. The ending was symbolized by two dramatic events that no one that I knew at least, had expected. First, the fall of the Berlin Wall.
In plain German, my mother and my father are in West Berlin. Can I go and visit them now?
Sure.
Wow.
There's no way to describe the tidal wave of euphoria that hits Berlin the night of November the 9th. Out of thin air, thousands upon thousands of East and West Berliners suddenly appear at each of the six border checkpoints, shouting and rejoicing, crying and even praying. Is it true what they're saying on radio and television? Has the wall, my God, is it really possible? Has the wall been opened like a floodgate? And everyone is riding on a crest of joy, except perhaps the East German border guards, helpless in the face of the elated crowds. At the border checkpoints, any semblance of order has been disregarded in the tumult of emotion. And one thing is clear beyond doubt. This absurd symbol of a divided Germany, the wall, has become obsolete overnight.
Then, less than a year later, equally dramatic and equally unexpected, was the fall of the Soviet Union.
For the first time in 70 years, the Russian national flag was unfurled at the Kremlin. All over the Soviet Union, people tore down the symbols of an ideology that had shaped so much of the 20th century. The people were asked to put their faith in new gods, democracy and capitalism.
Cold War, I believed that it was necessary to take the risks associated with large nuclear arsenals. But after the Cold War ended, I believed that it was no longer necessary to take those terrible risks. Indeed, I came to believe that I had a moral imperative to begin working to help dismantle this deadly nuclear legacy. My first opportunity to act on that belief came in 1994 when I was asked by President Clinton to be his Secretary of Defense. I started my journey on the less traveled road by making it my top priority as Secretary of Defense to reduce the dangers of the Cold War nuclear arsenal. The greatest immediate danger was that nuclear weapons in Ukraine, Kazakhstan, and Belarus would fall into the hands of a terrorist. When the Soviet Union collapsed, these new republics had inherited the nuclear weapons that were then on their soil. Ukraine, for example, had more nuclear weapons than the United Kingdom, France, and China combined, and they were going through great social, political, and economic turbulence. Through adroit diplomacy, we were able to get these new republics to agree to give up their nuclear weapons. This agreement required us to assist them in the complex and expensive dismantlement process. And as the Secretary of Defense, I was responsible under the Nunn-Lugar program for executing that assistance. And I decided to carry out that responsibility by personally overseeing the dismantlement at Prvomaysk, which was then the largest ICBM complex in the former Soviet Union. On the first trip, I was taken to the control center, where the officer in charge showed me a practice countdown. And he'd been asked to do a show and tell. What do you do for a show and tell for a visiting secretary? You do a practice countdown. Never has the full horror of the Cold War been clearer to me than standing there watching those young officers practice launching 700 nuclear warheads at targets in the United States. On my second and third visits, I oversaw the dismantlement of these missiles and their silos. On my last visit to Prvomaysk, I joined with the Minister of Defense of Russia and the Minister of Defense of Ukraine, and we planted sunflowers at the site of what had once been a deadly missile field.
I told the couple who lives here about the line from Voltaire's Candide.
Я сказав сім'ї, яка тут проживає, про одну з моїх улюблених цитат із роману Кандид, автор Волтер.
The most important thing we can do in life is to cultivate our garden and to live in peace.
Найважливіше, що ми можемо вчинити в нашому житті, це є піклуватися городом і вирощувати на ньому мир.
They are cultivating their garden now, and we will live in peace.
Отож, вони піклуються своїм городом, і ми будемо жити.
Ministers of Defense planting sunflowers. That some flowers really did grow there, too. You know, I thought this was something symbolic, and I was disappointed to learn that sunflowers are the cash crop of that part of Ukraine, the most important product for them. Had no symbolism at all as far as the Ukrainians are concerned. In all, during my time in office, I helped bring about the dismantlement of about 8,000 nuclear weapons in the United States and in the former Soviet Union. And assisted three nations, Kazakhstan, Belarus, and Ukraine, to go entirely non-nuclear. This was the first time since the dawn of the nuclear age that nuclear proliferation had actually been reversed. Also in my last year in office, I steered the Comprehensive Test Ban Treaty through the Pentagon so that the president could sign it. So in 1997, when I left office, I believe that we were well on the way to mitigating the deadly nuclear legacy of the Cold War. But since then, the effort has stalled and even reversed. 2 years after I left office, the Senate rejected the ratification of the Comprehensive Test Ban Treaty. Russia and China are now building new nuclear weapons. North Korea has built a small nuclear arsenal, and Iran is following in their footsteps. Additionally, Pakistan, with an arsenal of about 100 nuclear weapons, is a growing danger. The government in Pakistan is being challenged by an increasingly violent Al-Qaeda and Taliban militias. And to add to the danger, the Pakistani government has released AQ Khan, the notorious peddler of nuclear technology. At precisely the same time that nuclear weapons were proliferating, we began to see the emergence of catastrophic terrorism on a global scale.
Thank you. theoretical question. The 9/11 Commission reports Al-Qaeda has been trying to acquire or make a nuclear weapon for a decade. Could they do that?
It is not an exaggeration to say that the conflation of these two dangers has put the world at a nuclear tipping point, which is the subject of my talk tonight, the nuclear tipping point. If Iran and North Korea cannot be stopped from building nuclear arsenals, I believe that we will cross that nuclear tipping point with consequences that are more dangerous than most people can imagine. In the face of those ominous developments, George Shultz decided to hold a workshop at Stanford in 2006, the 20th anniversary of the Reykjavik summit. At that summit meeting back in 1986, President Reagan and President Gorbachev had seriously explored the idea of eliminating nuclear weapons.
We're not just discussing limits on a further increase of nuclear weapons. We seek instead to reduce their number. We seek the total elimination one day of nuclear weapons from the face of the earth.
President Reagan and Soviet President Gorbachev came close to agreement on that vision in 1986 when the two met in Reykjavik, Iceland. But disagreements over missile defense proved a stumbling block.
I believe that Reykjavik was the real pinnacle of international politics. That is to say, from the high ground, we saw the prospects of a future world, and we both believed that a world of the future could prosper only if it's a world without nuclear weapons.
The two presidents actually came close to an agreement, but in the end, backed away. Most security specialists at the time were incredulous that the two presidents would even discuss such an idea. And I must admit that I was one of those skeptics. But 20 years later, at the Stanford workshop, we concluded we ought to have revived the idea that Gorbachev and Reagan had discussed at that summit meeting, moving towards a world without nuclear weapons. We believed that some really dramatic action was necessary to stop this terrible drift towards a nuclear catastrophe. And so four of us, George Shultz, Henry Kissinger, Sam Nunn, and myself, joined forces to write two op-eds in January of 07 and January of 08, prescribing such dramatic actions. We did not expect much more from our first op-ed than the usual kind of response that an academic gets from writing an op-ed. But we were actually caught by quite surprise. We were swamped with reaction. Letters all around the world, mostly of the view that the world was long overdue for a serious reevaluation of nuclear weapons and nuclear posture. Buoyed by this response, we scheduled meetings with senior government officials and former officials in countries all over the world, Russia, China, India, Japan, United Kingdom. In response to our op-eds and visits, other former officials around the world began speaking out for a world without nuclear weapons. And so, just as Graham referred to us as the Four Horsemen, there are now Four Horsemen in Russia, in the United Kingdom, in Germany, in Italy, in Australia, all around the world, groups are being formed, promoting in their own countries the same objective. And considering the deeply moral issues involved, religious voices began to be heard. During the Cold War, Catholic bishops and evangelicals had asked whether there could ever be a moral justification of the use or the threat of use of a weapon so deadly. Most of the religious articles during the Cold War concluded that nuclear deterrence could be justified. But now, with the ending of the Cold War, it was time to re-examine that question. So we ended 2008 with more response and more unofficial report than we had expected. But such unofficial or track two activities can only go so far. Particularly in this field, the actions that make a difference must be taken by governments. And to that point, no significant action or statement had been made by any government. And then, in 2009, a miracle occurred. I still consider it a miracle. Just 10 weeks after he was inaugurated, President Obama made his famous speech in Prague.
The existence of thousands of nuclear weapons is the most dangerous legacy of the Cold War. Today, the Cold War has disappeared, but thousands of those weapons have not. In a strange turn of history, the threat of global nuclear war has gone down, but the risk of a nuclear attack has gone up. I state clearly and with conviction, America's commitment to seek the peace and security of a world without nuclear weapons.
A few months later, at a summit meeting in Moscow, President Obama and President Medvedev jointly declared their support of a world without nuclear weapons and made a commitment to move towards a new nuclear arms treaty. Then in September, President Obama submitted a resolution to the UN Security Council supporting nuclear disarmament. Amazingly, this resolution passed 15-0. How often does a Security Council resolution get a 15-0 vote? And governments all over the world begin to weigh in. United Kingdom, Norway, Italy, Finland are all sponsoring non-proliferation projects. Japan and Australia, the governments of Japan and Australia, formed an international commission on nuclear non-proliferation and disarmament, of which I was the American commissioner. So 2009 was a year of unprecedented actions that none of us could have predicted at the beginning of the year. It truly was an honest mirabilis, a year of miracles. That term has been used to describe two different miraculous years in science. 1666, when Newton published his landmark papers on theory of gravitation and his famous optics paper. And in 1905, when Einstein published three remarkable papers, one of which included the theory of relativity. In my lifetime, I can remember Václav Havel calling 1989 an honest mirabilis, a year of miracles. That was the year, as you remember, when all European nations gained their independence, essentially bloodlessly. And of course, that year was culminated by the fall of the Berlin Wall. I do not mean to suggest that the developments of 2009 are equal in significance to those remarkable events, but considering my expectations going into 2009, I really do consider it a year of miracles. Indeed, I move to quote Victor Hugo, who more than a century ago wrote, "More powerful than the tread of mighty armies is an idea whose time has come." But if 2009 was a year of miracles, 2010 had to be a year of action. And in fact, the action exploded in one memorable week in April. On Tuesday morning of that week, President Obama released his eagerly awaited nuclear posture review. On Tuesday afternoon of that same day, President Obama held a premiere showing of the movie Nuclear Tipping Point at the White House. His guests were the four of us who had produced the movie and our spouses, as well as his national security team. The president introduced the movie by saying that our views on nuclear weapons had guided his own views and that he wanted his national security team to be similarly guided. We could hardly have asked for a better premiere of that movie. On Wednesday, President Obama left for Prague to meet with President Medvedev. On Thursday, they signed the New START Treaty. On Friday, they had a bilateral meeting with President Medvedev. On Saturday and Sunday, 47 world leaders arrived in Washington. And on Monday and Tuesday, all those leaders met for a nuclear summit for the purpose of strengthening controls on fissile material. What a week. 2 weeks later, the Senate held its first hearing on the New START Treaty, with the first two witnesses being Jim Schlesinger and myself. The hearing was generally friendly. Indeed, the chairman and ranking members, Senator Kerry and Senator Lugar, could hardly have been more gracious. But there was formidable opposition in the Senate to this treaty, being led by Senator John Kyle. If the Senate had not ratified New START, the United States would have forfeited its right to provide any leadership in this field, and this whole effort worldwide would simply have fizzled out. But in December, the Senate, against the expectations of many astute political observers, ratified the New START Treaty with 71 favorable votes, the only time this Senate has voted 71 in favor of anything. This was made possible by 13 Republicans going against their leadership and voting for ratification. The following month, the Russian Congress ratified the treaty, and so it's now official. So where do we go from here? What does the future hold for nuclear disarmament? The next challenge will be getting the Comprehensive Test Ban Treaty ratified, which will be even more difficult than the ratification of New START, since ratification was rejected by the Senate in 1998. Ratification will depend on convincing the senators on two points that were in contention back in 1998, that the extensive arrays of seismic monitors built since 1998 can provide adequate verification, and that the so-called stockpile stewardship program, also started in the late 90s, can provide adequate confidence in our nuclear stockpile without testing. I believe that both of those points can be successfully argued to any objective observer. If we succeed in the Comprehensive Test Ban Treaty ratification, the next challenge will be the negotiation of a follow-on treaty to New START. Here, progress will require cooperation in ballistic missile defense, which is both a political and a technical challenge. It will require verification of warheads. Up to now, we've only been verification of missiles, which is much easier. And that is a very, very significant technological challenge. And the inclusion of tactical nuclear weapons, which is both a political and a technical challenge. And perhaps the greatest challenge ahead of us is successfully curtailing the nuclear weapons program of North Korea and Iran. All of these goals present daunting political challenges. But as daunting as these near-term goals are, they are the necessary gatekeepers to achieving real progress in the field of nuclear disarmament. The International Commission on Nonproliferation of Nuclear Disarmament, of which, as I've already told you, I was a member, designated them as phase one of a comprehensive disarmament program and called for them to be achieved by 2012, which is coming right around the bend. In the second phase, they called for no less daunting actions. They called for the United States and Russia to dismantle their nuclear weapons, including the weapons in reserve and in storage, not covered by the present treaties, at an aggregate rate of 1,500 a year, until they were down to something they called a minimization point. And at that point, the world would take a deep breath and decide whether we're ready to go all the way to zero. Now, I know that most of you, at least most of the people I have talked with, believe that moving towards a world without nuclear weapons is, in fact, mission impossible. And I must concede that the skeptics among you have the history of the last few decades on your side. But I would like to conclude my talk by giving you the views of some prominent pragmatists who would hold more hopeful views on nuclear disarmament. I'm going to begin by paraphrasing President John Kennedy. I'm reading now. "Too many of us think," he said, "that it is impossible to contain proliferation, but that is a dangerous and a defeatist belief. It leads to the conclusion that nuclear terrorism or nuclear war is inevitable, that we are gripped by forces that we cannot control." Then Kennedy goes on to say, "We need not accept that view. Our problems are man-made, and therefore they can be solved by man." To which I would add that while the problems were man-made, the solutions will come from women as well as men. Sam Nunn has spent most of his career working to strengthen American security and fully understands the huge task ahead of us in nuclear disarmament. He compares the task to that of climbing a tall mountain whose top is obscured by clouds.
The way I view it is that if you view the goal of getting to zero as the top of the mountain in terms of nuclear weapons, then we can't even see the top of the mountain today. We're heading down, we're not heading up. It's going to take a long time to see the top of the mountain, but I think we have an obligation to our children and to our grandchildren to build paths up the mountain, to get other people to go up the mountain with us, because this cannot be unilateral.
We don't quite know what the mountaintop will look like. We don't quite know how to get to that mountaintop. And we won't make any proposals that we cannot justify, but we are determined to go up that mountaintop.
If we don't give them that hope, those of us who've been through the Cold War, if we don't give them that hope and that vision, then it's going to be extremely difficult to prevent the kind of nuclear nightmare that is looming on the horizon.
George Shultz and Henry Kissinger have also thought deeply about the difficulty on the path to nuclear disarmament. Here is a brief video encapsulating their views.
A man named Max Kampelman, who had been my counselor when I was Secretary of State, made an eloquent statement emphasizing the importance of talking about what ought to be. If you're constantly mired in what is, and you never look at what ought to be, you're never going to really get anywhere. And he used the Declaration of Independence as an example. All men are created equal in 1776. Are you kidding? We had slaves. Women couldn't vote. If you had to have property in order to vote. We had the ought up there. And gradually, over time, often with a lot of pain and agony and difficulty, but gradually, the is has come closer to the ought. And we ought to have a world free of nuclear weapons.
Once nuclear weapons are used, we will be driven to take global measures to prevent it. So some of us have said, let's ask ourselves, we have to do it afterwards. Why don't we do it now?
Well, I've given you the views of Kennedy, Shultz, Kissinger, and Nunn. But my benediction to you will be my personal views, a summary of where my journey on this less traveled road has, in fact, taken me.
Over the long term, we need to be heading towards the total elimination of nuclear weapons. And over the short term, we need to be taking the steps to reduce the danger that the nuclear weapons we already have could be used. This is such an important problem in my mind that it dwarfs all other considerations. And I have myself decided to devote the balance of my career to working to achieve that goal.
So for the balance of my career, I expect to be traveling to Washington every other week, as well as making extended trips to Delhi, London, Tokyo, Seoul, Moscow, and Beijing, instead of enjoying my golden years in that Garden of Eden known as Palo Alto. I do this because I believe that time is not on our side, and because having helped to build the nuclear arsenal, I know better than most how to dismantle it, and I believe that I have a special responsibility to do so. Indeed, I want to express this last thought with more lines from Robert Frost. The woods are lovely, dark, and deep, but I have promises to keep and miles to go before I sleep, and miles to go before I sleep. Thank you.
I told Bill the only time people stand up in the forum is to protest. So, though in this instance, extremely appropriate. And having watched Bill over this amazing career and knowing the difference between the temperature in Palo Alto today and Cambridge, for example, and watching the way in which he still can get on the red eye, going back and forth regularly, when he's not just going back and forth to D.C., but actually internationally, and the passion that he brings to this proposition, I would say is just a wonder to behold. So lots to discuss tonight. Points of agreement and disagreement are welcome, but alternative speeches aren't. So the rules are: introduce yourself, put your question with a question mark, and then we'll turn to Bill. And this gentleman is first.
Hi, my name is Hanif Javeri. I'm a student at the Kennedy School. I noticed you spoke a lot about countries like North Korea and Pakistan and even countries like China, but you didn't speak at all about countries like India, which are known to repossess civilian nuclear technology and use it for their nuclear weapons programs. Given that that's the case, where do you stand on the selective treatment of India with respect to civilian nuclear technology and access to uranium?
I think the question is referring specifically to an agreement that was made during the Bush administration to make a special dispensation to India and to allow them to have share nuclear technology for their civilian works. I thought it was a bad agreement. I was in favor of broadening our friendship with India. I was willing to help them with the civilian nuclear program, but I thought we should have gotten firm agreements on constraints on that being used for military purposes. So I think the agreement was okay as far as it went, but it did not go far enough, and that it should have included those constraints.
Gentleman in the lodge.
Hi, Mr. Perry. I'm John Solo. I'm a freshman at the college from Turkey. Before saying anything, I would like to thank you for your service to the world and for your poetically beautiful lecture. My question has to do with something that Mr. Allison has earlier told an audience that I was a part of in the fall. I attended a talk about Iran, and in that session, the prevailing idea presented by Mr. Allison was that Iran was not necessarily trying to get the weapons, but they were doing all of this for political leverage and for their own economic benefit. I was going to ask whether you would agree with that point, and where does that leave us with preventing Iran from getting nuclear weapons?
I expressed in my talk a lot of concern about Iraq getting nuclear weapons. I have no concern about them having a peaceful nuclear program. I think they're entitled to have one. They want to have one. There's no reason why they should not have one. I have met two times with the Iranian National Security Advisor, trying to understand from him, these are unofficial meetings, where they were really going. He insists that they do not plan to make nuclear weapons. On the other hand, they have dissembled with the International Atomic Energy Agency. They have had covert programs, and so it's hard to believe them, to be honest with you. I'm concerned about any new nation getting nuclear weapons for several reasons, but not the least of which is it makes it impossible to keep going with the program to have the present nuclear powers start to dismantle their nuclear weapons. I'm also concerned particularly about Iran because of the danger of proliferation from Iran. But I think Iran also has a very special case because they have quite specifically challenged the existence of the State of Israel and threatened, in so many words, to wipe them from the map face of the earth. Now, for a country that has nuclear weapons, that's something that's possible to do. And so most people in this country, probably including myself, tend to dismiss the Iranian comments as bravado. I have to tell you, I've talked with the Israeli leaders and the Israeli military leaders. They do not consider it bravado. They think they have to take it seriously. So they have threatened to conduct a military strike against the Iranian nuclear facility if it reaches the point where it can make nuclear weapons. I take them quite seriously. So there's a new and different complication in the Iranian nuclear program, which is it could lead to an Israeli strike against Israel, which even if it was successful would have a whole host of consequences, nearly all of which are terrible. So we should be doing everything we can to prevent that strike, but the only thing I can think of that would really be persuasive to the Israeli government is make meaningful actions to curtailing the Iranian nuclear weapon program.
Thank you.
Gentleman in the lodge.
Hi, yeah, my name is Harlan. I'm a sophomore at the college. My question actually references both of the questions that preceded this. It's a question which, as you noted in your talk, during the Cold War, it made sense that the United States had nuclear weapons to respond to the Russian threat. Now, in regional considerations, like that between Pakistan and India, or that of Israel, for example, how do you begin to approach the issue of getting those three countries to even consider getting rid of their nuclear arsenals?
When I was the Secretary of Defense, I made visits to both India and Pakistan, telling them, look, I know you have a nuclear weapon program underway. I don't want to discuss whether or not you have it. I know you do. I'm here to advise you not to take it to the testing and deployment stage, because I think that would have a whole set of unfortunate consequences. I'm not arguing this for worldwide proliferation issues, which are serious enough. I'm only arguing that it would be a greater danger to you. I think the greatest danger that these Indian and Pakistani nuclear weapons pose is to each other, and to the possibility of a regional war occurring between those two countries, which could erupt into a nuclear war. Obviously, I believed strongly at the time, I believe that today. I made the argument passionately to the Indian and Pakistani government. Obviously, I made it unsuccessfully, because they went ahead and did precisely what I was arguing they should not do. Worse than that, today, Pakistan is working to greatly expand its nuclear arsenal. And this is a country that has a government whose stability is threatened by violent insurgents going on in the northern part of the country. One can only imagine what would happen if the Taliban and Al-Qaeda insurgencies were to be successful in overthrowing the government in Pakistan. And now we have a Taliban-type government holding 100 nuclear weapons. This is a very dreary prospect. Even without that, though, there's a possibility of one or of some of their weapons or some of their fissile material being overtaken by the insurgency. So I think if I had to say the single most dangerous situation in the world today relative to nuclear proliferation is in Pakistan, not because the Pakistan government is a danger to this, but because they're in danger of being overthrown or they're in danger of losing control of some of the material. And that is number one on my list of nuclear nightmares.
And Bill, if I can push you a little further, because I think the question wants to, there was kind of two parts, and the other part was, so if your position on nuclear weapons and the extent to which they don't make sense for the U.S. today, given that it's after the Cold War, is part of the logic of the situation. If you're trying to persuade the North Koreans who may feel threatened or the Pakistanis who may feel threatened that they should give up their nuclear weapons, how does the abolition of the zero nuclear weapons agenda connect to these recalcitrants?
Excellent question. It's very hard to answer, but I'll make a quick stab at it. In the case of North Korea, it's not academic to me. I went to North Korea in Pyongyang in 1998 and tried to negotiate with the North Koreans about giving up the nuclear weapons. I thought then, and I still think today, that was a successful negotiation. And had it been carried through to completion, that problem would have been resolved by now. But the essence of the negotiation was offering to North Korea the security assurances they needed so that they not feel threatened by the United States. We were prepared to do that. I think that would have made a big difference from their point of view. The South Koreans and the Japanese were prepared to offer economic incentives to them. So the package which was offered to North Korea back in 1998 was a two-handed package. On the one hand, we were offering economic incentives, and security assurances on the other understanding, but if you don't do it, there's going to be a lot of trouble with us. So it was a, and I think that was successful, and we were very close to having an agreement with the North Koreans when the administration changed, and they cut off all discussion and all negotiations, and the rest is history. On Pakistan, there would be no, I wouldn't even waste my breath talking with Pakistanis and Indians about giving up nuclear weapons if we did not have some basis for believing we had a reconciliation between the two countries. We had to deal with the fundamental issues between those two countries. That's why they have nuclear weapons. And I think if we could, if it's possible to deal with that problem, then we might have some basis for causing them to roll back the nuclear weapons. That's one part of the package. The other part of the package has to be they have to see the United States and Russia and China, so all the other countries rolling back too.
Gentleman on the left. That's you. On the floor, I'm sorry.
My name is Alex Rossolimo. I'm chairman of the Center for Security and Social Progress, a think tank. Originally, I planned to ask a question dealing with nuclear issues, but after listening to your talk about the road you took and reading your biography, I would like to ask a more personal question, if I may. All your university degrees are in bachelor's, master's, and PhD are in mathematics. So my question is, how and why did you make the transition from mathematics to research and engineering and eventually national defense?
When I returned to Stanford after being Secretary of Defense, the math department asked me to speak at their graduation ceremonies. And I said, what should I talk about? And that was the question they posed to me. So I got up and I gave a one sentence answer, which was, I got there by a random walk process. Now, to a mathematician, that answer has special meaning because there's a famous problem, random walk problem in mathematics. And then I went on and spent another 15 minutes elaborating on that. But it was a random set of actions, the most fundamental of which is that while I was in graduate school, working on my PhD, I was married and we had two children. And just about my second year of graduate school, we were delivered with twins, two more children. So we had four children in graduate school, no independent source of income. And so I had to, beyond my graduate assistantship, I had to go out and get a job too. So I had the only company in town that gave me a job was a defense electronics company. So I got into the defense part of the business, and I also had to learn about engineering to do that. So that started me off on that path. It's a long, complicated story, but that's the short answer to it.
Okay, but I think very relevant for mathematicians here. Yes, please.
Good evening. My name is Ari Colon. I'm an intensive care physician from Hawaii and New York and an alum of the Kennedy School class of 2008. I'd like to say thank you very much for your service, your brilliant service for decades to our country and world. You've made it a safer place. My question tonight has to do with Colonel Gaddafi. I'm very, very saddened at watching gunships murder the innocent protesters wanting a better life there, and seeing his military troops burned on CNN with blurred pictures. My rhetorical question, and it's theoretical at the same time, is, now that it appears that Colonel Gaddafi is fairly weakened, is this the time that possibly someone with drones could give special assistance to the people that want freedom? Do we have a moral and ethical imperative as one of the leading powers of the world to intervene when innocent people are being slaughtered by the government?
My answer to that question is yes, with qualifications. And the qualification is, what does intervene mean? And if intervening meant sending a Marine Expeditionary Force to land there, I would probably want to think twice about it. But certainly intervention in terms of strong moral support for them, intervention in terms of sending aid, intervention in terms, I think we could go as far as sending our Air Force over to stop their Air Force from strafing their own people. That I think I'd be willing, if I was Secretary of Defense, I would be recommending that to the President at this point.
It's just a theoretical question. Thank you.
I think it's a good question, and I think that it actually elicited the Secretary of Defense, Bill Perry, who
was never shy about the use of American military force for purposes that he thought were justified in the lodge.
Hi, my name is Claire Duncan, and I'm a freshman here at the college. I was wondering, there seems to be quite a bit of consensus among academics and former Defense Department members such as yourself about the need to cut down on nuclear arsenals and such and eventually reach a zero point. However, within the U.S. and on the political scene, it's either not very high on the list, at least at the moment, considering our economic and social troubles. Either that or there's quite a bit of opposition within Congress. What sort of political maneuvers do you think are necessary to really bring this to the very forefront of debate and to really convince Congress that something must be done in the near future?
You're not going to like the answer to this question. What would bring it to the forefront and cause Congress and the executive branch to really act would be an act of nuclear terrorism. What we have been trying to do, and suggested by Henry Kissinger's comment, if you're going to do all these things after that happens, why don't you think about doing them before? An ounce of prevention here would be in order.
Thank you.
Okay, this lady, please.
Good evening, Mr. Secretary. Thank you so much for coming to speak to us tonight and for your service and for your commitment. My name is Leilani Johnson. I'm a mid-career MPA candidate here. Firstly, I would like to say that I wholeheartedly agree with your strategy to include more women in the solution, and I thank you for proposing that. And secondly, I wanted to ask for your comments on the rise in demand for nuclear power along with the mission to disarm and for nuclear non-proliferation.
I generally am supportive of increasing nuclear power as a means of decreasing our carbon footprint and decreasing our dependence on foreign oil for both of those reasons. The danger with nuclear power is not from the reactors themselves, but from the fuel cycle that is attendant to those reactors. And so if nuclear reactors are going to proliferate around the world, my hope would be that could be done in such a way that the new countries and the new organizations getting the nuclear reactors were not also pursuing the nuclear fuel cycle. Having said that, I must tell you there's not much support for that point of view around the world. Many of the nations believe that they are have some kind of a birthright to be able to make their own nuclear fuel. The danger, of course, of making nuclear fuel is once you have enriched uranium, once you've developed a system for enriching uranium suitable for reactors, you just have to leave that system run a little bit longer and you get uranium that's suitable for making nuclear bombs. So it's a very dangerous situation. The danger, however, lies not in the reactors themselves, but in the fuel cycle. And so the big if you could separate these two out, then moving forward many more reactors is not a danger of proliferation. But if more reactors meant more countries with fuel cycles, more entities with fuel cycle, then we'd greatly increase the proliferation dangers.
This gentleman gets the last question, please. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Secretary.
The last question is always the hardest.
Not for me. It's an easy question. And I express the gratitude of everyone in this room and the billions of people in the world that appreciate the efforts that you're putting in to make the world a safer place. My understanding is that the United States has order of magnitude 40 to 50,000 nuclear weapon heads. We have about 40 to 50,000 nuclear weapons. And that we spend about 700...
It has a lot, but not that many.
Okay. Yeah. And we spend about $700 billion in military weaponry and defense. Yeah. Uh-huh. And we have about 1,000 points of soldiers and people around the world promoting militarism. So much of the dialogue on this crucial subject is quid pro quo. Wouldn't the path less traveled be for the United States to take unilateral action and cut down our massive amounts of nuclear weapons? After all, something like 15 or 20 of them would be enough to throw us into a nuclear winter and just show the world that we can lead by example.
Yes.
Thank you.
Graham, I'd like to answer a question that was not asked.
Okay, you can. I'm asking the question, and so what's the answer?
All right. The question I've often been asked, but did not come up tonight, about this four horsemen that you referred to, the average age of the four horsemen is 85.
Well, no, that's their chronological age.
Yeah, chronological
this is
age.
Not,
but nevertheless, it's been observed that we're probably not immortal. And therefore,
I don't see any evidence to the contrary.
So at George Shultz's, my answer to the question, I gave at George Shultz's 90th birthday party. I'll read it to you, and with apologies to Tennyson. It says, George, you and I are old, but old age hath yet its honor and its toil, and some work of noble note may yet be done. For though much is taken, much abides. And though we are not now that strength which in old days moved earth and heaven, that which we are, we are. Two equal tempers of heroic hearts, made weak by time and fate, but strong in will to strive, to seek, to find, and not to yield. Thank you.
I don't see any sign of aging. That's the only part I get to do. So we thank Bill Perry for giving the second McNamara Lecture. We look forward next year to the third McNamara Lecture, though we're going to have a hard time finding somebody to fill in equivalently. If you didn't get enough of Bill Perry tonight, which nobody ever does, if you look again at the forum website, you'll see Bill has been here three times previously talking about a range of topics, but for tonight, for challenging us all, as well as for what he does with his life, let's say thank you very much.